Okay. Mine will be a smaller scale intervention. I'm a literary historian, and I will basically try to answer the following question. What changes in the practice of literary history when you start using computers to think about literature? And there are various answers. The first is very simple. What changes is the very object of your study. It's not just the tools, because that's obvious. It's the object itself. Objects studied by contemporary historians, this is something Christoph Pomian, social intellectual historian, wrote some time ago. These objects, no one has ever seen them, and no one could ever have seen them, because they have no equivalent within lived experience. What did he mean by that? He also called them invisible objects. Why did he use this expression? Because he was thinking of new objects of historiography, like demographic trends, literacy rates, this kind of things. And it's true. No one can have a lived experience of such forces. Our objects, of course, are different. They're literary ones. But the logic behind the work is the same. The literary objects which have no equivalent within what most of us, perhaps all of us, would consider the lived experience of literature. There are many experiences, but still, you know, they would be outside, I assume, the range. So what are they like, these objects that we work on at the Literary Lab? I say we, I will often say we in this presentation, because it is really a group, the most important members of which are sitting back there and will do part of the presentation. There are things like this. I have only 10 minutes. There is a poster session afterwards. We can get into the detail. Let me just say that this charts frequent words in green and gold and associates them by position with the four types of clauses, the red lines, the red vectors, that are particularly important in 19th century novels. This is the kind of object we work on. And by this, I mean that we spent several hours looking in detail at this construction and at a series of charts like this and trying to figure out what caused the distribution and what it meant for our study of 19th century narrative. This is one of our objects, or this. Look at the red segments down here. They chart the declining presence of loud-speaking verbs in 19th century. It's a corpus of about 3,000 19th century English novels. And as the loud-speaking verbs decline, what happens is the silencing of the English novel that 21-year-old Holst Katzma discovered in our database last year, thus earning Stanford's Kennedy Prize for the best undergraduate thesis in the humanities. Again, this is the kind of objects we study. No one had ever seen them. No one had ever thought about literature in these terms, because these objects exist on a different scale from that of that at which we typically experience literature. So the object is new because the scale is new. It's much bigger than we're used to, or much smaller, or both, but it's really different in that respect. It's 3,000 novels and a handful of words for loudness. Or here, I'll return to this, very confusing, but it's 11 different novelistic genres and 20 verb forms, the black lines that distribute, that push these various novels belonging to the genres in various positions. No one experiences literature like as a scatterplot of verb forms and genres. Reading a novel, watching a play, listening to a ballad, that's the lived experience of literature. Instead, in this kind of work, literature is, how shall we put it, decomposed into its extremes, as here. But then this radical reduction to the extreme also allows us to see a relationship between the very small and the very large. It allows us, for instance, to see how the passive past simple, which is this verb form here, is decisive for a group of genres, and especially for Gothic novels in their characterization, or the use of the progressives for the Bildungsroman, and so on. Again, we can go into the details later. And you see, it's not just a matter of seeing the relationship. The point is that once you have something like this, you can actually work on the relationship. You can change the variables. You can use adjectives instead of verbs. You can you can include stop words or exclude them, and so on. So you change the variables, and you basically run little experiments. It's a big word, but little experiments with historical evidence. And this also says something important about this new object of study. It's not a thing that we found somewhere. Often scholars find extremely important things in archives. That's not our way. It's not a thing we found. It's not a given. It's something constructed, which means it's a result of a new practice, really, of a new type of work, and a type of work that before the digital age was completely unimaginable. Which brings me to a question that I once heard from Richard Soller in the discussions that led to this evening. The question sounds like something like this: will the humanities in the digital age lose what has so powerfully characterized them, that is to say, the experience of reading a book from beginning to end? I will not answer for the humanities in general. Elaine has said things in that respect. Others also will. I will just say that for those of us who have decided to try and study literary history with digital corpora and algorithmic tools, then the answer is yes. Reading a book from the beginning to end loses its centrality because, for better and worse, it is no longer the foundation of this type of knowledge. Our objects are much bigger than a book, 11 genres, or much smaller than a book, a handful of verb forms. They're almost never a book. It's as if the pact with the digital had a price, and the price was this drastic loss of measure. There is something so human-sized about books, or we've grown accustomed to them so much that they just feel right in our size. Well, that measure is gone, and we are not at all happy that it's gone, but it seems to be a necessary aspect of this new approach. I want to be absolutely clear about this. This does not mean that literary scholars, let alone readers in general, should no longer read books. Reading is one of the greatest pleasures in life. It would be insane to give it up. What is at stake is not reading here. It is the continuity between the experience of reading a book and the production of knowledge. That's the point. I read a lot of books, and I actually work on the results of my reading of a lot of books. When I work in this mode in the literary lab, books are no longer the basis for our knowledge. Again, for better and worse, I'm sure Josh will speak more about the limits of this, but I'm perfectly aware of this. The lived experience of literature in this type of study no longer morphs into knowledge. It's no longer, as there is a wonderful expression by Paul Ricoeur, the hermeneutic of listening. It means you understand the text when you learn to listen to what the text is saying. Well, in this kind of work, we don't really listen to what a text is saying. We ask questions of corpora. The epistemology is really turned around. And we ask questions of large corpora, not of individual texts. Do we not read at all? No, not exactly, not even in this mode. You may have noticed there is a crazy outlier there at the top, in the top left corner. Each of these strips, by the way, stands for 200 sentences of a certain type that we have extracted from books. And that one at the top, which is really out of scale with anything else that happens in this chart, happens to be in the early chapters of Middlemarch. And its position was so extreme that we, of course, took those 200 sentences and read them very, very, very carefully. The question is, were we thereby reading Middlemarch? And honestly, I don't think so. Sentences came from Middlemarch, yes, but they couldn't be read like one reads a novel because they were not continuous with each other. They formed a series only on the basis of a grammatical question that we were asking the corpus to answer, grammatical peculiarity that we wanted to investigate. No one could have ever seen those 200 sentences while reading Middlemarch. So, in a sense, we were studying Middlemarch, but not by reading. So you see, the objects have changed, and the scale has changed, and the type of work. and the nature of the knowledge that we're after and the relationship with reading. And this, of course, raises all sorts of further questions. Fine. So are the new and the old knowledge in conflict? Are they complementary? Are they independent of and indifferent to each other? And the study of these new objects, has it achieved something important? Has it achieved anything? But we have very few minutes, and on the limits of the enterprise, the next speaker will speak.